Let's visit the 90s all over again. Put on those hammer pants. This is Dope Nostalgia.
Welcome to Dope Nostalgia, and this is episode 151 with me, Naomi. I'm your host. We are going to talk to an awesome R&B vocal group called 4PM, who had a massive hit with the cover of Sukiyaki back in the 90s. These are some of the nicest guys I've ever talked to. They were just absolute sweethearts. So I'm very excited to share what's coming up for them with you guys. And I hope you enjoy this episode. And here's a little information about 4PM.
Wikipedia moment.
Please bear in mind that Wikipedia is not to be taken as actual 100% fact. Any donkey could edit it at any time. If I'm reading you the artist's bio, that stuff is real truth.
4PM was an American male R&B group best known for their cover version of Sukiyaki, which peaked at number 8 on the U.S. Billboard Hot 100 in February 95. 4PM is an acronym meaning For Positive Music, meaning the band's music would not contain explicit lyrics, does not promote violence, and does not degrade women. The band has toured worldwide and remains popular, most notably in Japan. The group was started in 1991 in the suburbs of Baltimore, Maryland, by brothers Roberto Pena Jr., and Ray Pena with Larry McFarland and Moritz Ware. They were originally known as For Real, IV Real, as in the Roman numerals, and they played local talent shows. After a 1994 performance at a record release party, they were signed by Next Plateau Records and moved to New York City. Their debut album, Now's the Time, which peaked at 96 on the Billboard Top R&B Hip Hop Albums chart, included a cover version of Kiyo Sakamoto's 1960s hit Sukiyaki. The group's version of Sukiyaki peaked at number 8 and was certified gold in 1995. It also reached the top 5 in Australia and New Zealand. Now's the Time earned gold status in Canada and Japan and went platinum in Australia. Their second album, 1997's A Light in the Dark, didn't quite chart as well, but did include the minor hit I Gave You Everything, which peaked at 67 on Billboard's Hot R&B Hip Hop Singles and Tracks chart. After a brief hiatus, the group, minus Moritz Ware, regrouped and started Pena Brothers Productions. In 2000, they released a third album, For Positive Music, a mix of pop, R&B, hip hop, and Latin music on their own 4PM label. In 2001, they released a fourth album, Sweet Soul, on the Japanese Pony Canon label. And in 2008, they released Tracks for the Mass Movement. Want to know what they're up to now? Well, we're about to find out. Let's welcome the members of 4PM to Dope Nostalgia. Oh, it's so good to have you all here.
How you doing?
Excellent. Thank you, gentlemen. I'm Naomi from Canada.
Hi, Naomi from Canada. How are you?
I'm Ray.
Hi, Ray.
I'm Larry.
And I'm Larry. Can you repeat the last one? Sorry.
Roberto. Yeah.
Fantastic. 4PM. Welcome to Dope Nostalgia.
Thank you.
I'm digging the official 4PM shirt.
Hey. we'll get you one.
Oh, I would love one. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah. So this is a podcast where we talk with artists who had big things happen in the 90s and then see what they're doing now today as well. Because we want to make sure that we keep things current, as well as a little bit of reminiscing. Where are you based out of nowadays?
Well, we all started off the group in right outside of Baltimore, Maryland.
Yes.
So that's where we originated. That's where we were all living back in the 90s. And Ray and I are brothers. So we would spend time at either Ray's house, my house, Larry's house, rehearsing every day. We used to do a lot of a cappella, and that's how the group started. We did a lot of talent shows, and one of those performances led us to our record deal with Next Plateau and Sukiyaki and Ancient History.
But right now, to answer your question, I'm residing in South New Jersey.
Yeah.
Larry's in both Larry and Roberto in Maryland. Mm-hmm. Larry's in kind of northern Maryland. Bobby's over here by the beach.
Eastern Shore. He's living it up.
Yeah. We're actually about in Roberto's home right now as we speak. So.
But that's very close, right? South Jersey and Baltimore are pretty close together.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Awesome. I think it's very important to note to our listeners too that your music contains positive messages for positive music. Yes. And as your wiki was saying, it's very important that you have never degraded women in your songs. You try to keep things light and happy. And I think that's great.
Yeah. Well, you know, we the three of us have been husbands for a long time. We're fathers to daughters, you know, and we have mothers, you know. So the idea of degrading a woman in our music just really doesn't fit well with our morals and values at all. I mean, not that we would do it anyway, right? But you know, we thought it important not to go down that route, you know.
It's true.
Amen.
Yeah, we got a lot of support from our families, especially our mothers and aunts and, you know, our daughters especially. And we couldn't even imagine putting out music and then saying, hey, look at the new record we just produced, you know, and having to listen to it and like, really? That came out of you guys' mouths, you know, so.
My mother's German. She would beat me upside the head.
He ain't having it. Tell me about your experiences with Japan. Now, that's one of my bucket list places I have to visit one day. But the country of Japan has a huge love for you guys.
Yes.
Yeah, so the experience started with our very first single. You know, we recorded a song called Sukiyaki, as you know, and it opened up international doors. But one of the first countries to receive us with open arms was Japan, because the song has a much longer history than the group 4PM. It dates back to 1963. It was originally recorded by a Japanese artist by the name of Sakamoto Kyu. And if I can compare him, they say he's kind of like the Elvis Presley of Japan.
Oh, wow.
He died tragically in a plane crash and has always been not only a living legend, but a legend altogether. And so as soon as we released that song, Japan said, wow, you know, I mean, you pay tribute to Sakamoto Kyu. We love it. You know, and I think we probably traveled there over 30 times, maybe.
Yeah, over 30 times in 10 years.
Yeah. So it's just been like a second home in a way. And in fact, one of the songs that we're recording for our upcoming LP, which will be out sometime early part of 23, we got a song that's kind of an ode to Japan. It has some Japanese sort of inflections and nuances and instruments, just to kind of say thank you to Japan for being so sweet to us, you know.
That's awesome. You've spent obviously a lot of time there. Yes. Do you have some favorite things you like to do when you're in Japan?
Oh man.
Probably shopping.
Yeah, I was gonna say shopping. Yeah. It's awesome in Japan. Yeah.
Probably shopping. Yeah. I think different things. The fashion over there is way ahead of its time. The technology is way ahead of its time.
Yeah.
I mean, we were there at the very beginning of our career. And after every performance, we would stay back and sign autographs and take pictures with the fans. Mm-hmm. And you should have seen our faces the very first time a young lady came and says, can I get a picture? And instead of pulling out a Polaroid, she just flipped her phone and said, click. And it wasn't until maybe 3-4 years later until the U.S. started, you know, introducing the camera phones.
We were just like, wow. We were like, is this Star Trek? What's going on?
We were really amazed with she just took a picture with her phone. Are you kidding me?
Right.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah, I can imagine seeing that for the first time. I have memories of seeing the first digital camera I ever saw. I'm like, it's right there. The photo is, you don't have to wait for it to get developed.
Exactly. Wow. Exactly. Wow.
Unbelievable.
Yes. I think we're aging ourselves, aren't we?
I've accepted it. It's okay.
Right. Well, so have we. So have we.
It's all because of you. I'm feeling sad and blue. You went away. Now my life is just a rainy day. And I love you so. how much you'll never know. You've gone away and left me lonely. Untouchable memories seem to keep haunting me. Another love so true that once turned all my gray skies blue. But you disappeared. Now my eyes are filled with tears. And I'm wishing you were here with me. Soaked with love, all my thoughts of you. Now that you're gone, I just don't know what to do.
Now, after Sukiyaki, how did things change for you as a band after the big hit? What did you do next?
Oh, boy.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah. Sukiyaki was a hit, and we got to travel the world. We toured in Canada, of course, Australia, Japan, China, the Philippines, Singapore, Malaysia,
Indonesia,
Australia. We traveled the world. Unfortunately, what happened for us is while the hit was taking us to all these foreign places, we started coming down on the charts in the U.S.
Right.
So, but the record company decided, while the going is hot, just stay out there. Right. When we got back to the States to try to say, okay, now let's get the U.S. on this party ride, we had already started coming down the charts, and the audiences were like, all right, well, who are they? Mm-hmm. So we went in. Recorded the second album, recorded it. We renegotiated our contract for better terms. We had great songs on the second album, but then the relationship between our record companies kind of failed, and we got lost in that contractual
shuffle.
So we ended up, instead of being with the independent company that we signed with and was really nurturing us, we went with the larger company that was not really in our corner as much, and we just kind of went by the wayside. So
that's just how it goes.
Yeah.
That's rough.
It was pretty humbling, after having all those, 4-star hotels and limousines and audiences, and then all of a sudden, okay, well, now what are we going to do?
Yeah. It's hard. The U.S. market is not only hard to crack, but it's hard to maintain a foothold. It's like you have to do it so quickly.
Yes, it is. Yeah, the attention spans, I think, of Americans are getting shorter and shorter, I think.
Oh, yeah. I think that's worldwide. Everything you have to catch your instant attention.
That's right. Everything's been measured now by TikTok. 30-second clips.
That is true.
I was just saying to someone the other day, I'm like, I wonder if it's in a songwriter's best interest to put the chorus always right at the beginning of the song nowadays.
Yeah.
Because there are a lot of songs that do that already.
Yeah. And the standard length of songs now are like 2.5 to 3.5 minutes.
Right.
Whereas, back in the day, you always
four to six,
somewhere in there. Yeah. So. Yeah. A lot has changed.
But that's okay. Then you guys went on and created the Pena Brothers Productions, right?
Yes,
sure did.
What happened with it?
As you probably know, once you're a lover of music, you just can't let that go. So, we wanted to kind of keep a foothold in the business. And we were fortunate enough to get a release from all of our contracts. So we got released from our major label, our production deal, our management deal, and it freed us up to do our own thing. So naturally, there were a lot of groups, especially in that time, trying to go the independent route. And so we got in the studio, wrote a bunch of songs, we packaged it, and we didn't know much about the business, right? But we searched and Google this and Google that and found out, hey, we can actually go and get CDs packaged ourselves from through this company. And, you know, and so we just went through the process. We had a photo shoot done, you know, the whole nine yards, and we put it out. It didn't really fare as well as we wanted it to, but the experience was worth its weight in gold, just being able to go through it, learn the ins and outs. And yeah. Of course, we all know now that the music business has changed dramatically, right? So, you know, there aren't too many people holding CDs anymore. You know what I mean? So now we're jumping back in this new game, but we're fortunate now to have a team who they have their intelligence, you know, glued to what's going on right now, and they understand the internet and all the algorithms and what's really cool with music. So we, you know, we're fortunate this go round. We're doing it independently now this time again. But we were able to put a really nice distribution and marketing team together to help us get this new music out that we're putting out.
Oh, that's a blessing. I'm glad.
Yeah. We're excited.
We're definitely excited. So.
Yeah. Hey, the bottom line is, if you're happy while you're doing it, that's what matters. And it sounds like since you guys took control, it's probably brought you a lot more happiness in what you do.
Oh, it did. Oh, yeah. It was very stressful the first time around, not knowing what was going on. We were just more like puppets. So.
I think right now we're in that little limbo kind of time where we've recorded the first four tracks for the LP. Mm. We have the next four being produced, the music, waiting for a recording schedule to go in and do those songs. Last week we finished the photo shoot, you know, for all our publicity and social media content. On the 19th of November, we shoot the video for the first single. And our tentative release date is December 16th for everything on all platforms. So awesome. Now it's the waiting game, and that has us kind of like, oh man, can it go any quicker? You know?
Yeah, the excitement and the anxiety while you wait.
Exactly. Absolutely.
Exactly.
Oh, well, who did you get to meet during the time that was a big influence on you? And did you get to learn anything from any of your idols in the music business?
Oh wow. We've had a few interesting experiences. Larry and I were in an elevator in Japan. I believe we were in an elevator, or maybe we were in a lobby at the hotel somewhere. Yeah. We met Peebo Bryson.
Nice.
And we spoke to him for a few minutes, and I think Larry asked him the question, so what's the secret in keeping your voice, you know, fresh and going this and that and the other? And I think his response was Lay's potato chips, you know?
he actually had a bag of Lay's in his hand. Right. Yeah, I guess you're telling
he
me.
He said, you know, keep the vocal cords nice and coated and greasy.
The salt and the grease.
Needless to say, Larry's become a big Lay's man since then.
Yeah, that corporation should be helping him out.
Right.
So, okay.
So we got some pretty good advice from him and some other people. I think we met Tony Bennett. He gave us some great words of advice one time. We met Will Smith in an airport. He gave us some really good advice. So there's been
a number of
big names that we come across and had chance to share the stage with. In fact, we were at a stylistics concert.
Yeah.
In Japan, I believe it was, and they called us up on the stage, so we got a chance to sing with them on the stage, and that was just like a moment that,
right.
You know, somebody had to pinch me to let me know it was real because it was so surreal at the time. Yeah. So,
another big one was the group Taste of Honey actually did Sukiyaki prior to us doing it. 81. Yeah, and one of the surviving member of Taste of Honey was actually in Japan doing an intimate jazz performance with her band. And the interpreters and the managers there, after we did our performance one night, they told us, get out of your, you know, suits and all that, get comfortable, we're gonna take you guys out to eat. So we go to eat, they take us to this club, lo and behold, here's the original singer of Taste of Honey on stage. And we got to go on stage with her and perform. So that was amazing.
That was nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, a lot of fun memories.
What a cool moment that would be.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
We've been blessed and had some cool moments.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I love the energy that you guys put out. It's just, it makes you feel good. I love it.
Thank you. You have a great energy yourself.
Well, thanks.
Thank you very much.
I see you like Prince because you got Purple Rain shirt on.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
That's definitely one of the legends right there.
Yeah, he is.
Gone too soon, right?
Oh, 100%.
Way too soon.
So many legends we've lost.
Yeah, unfortunately.
Yeah. I don't think I own a t-shirt that's not a music shirt. So,
Good deal. Nothing wrong with that.
Good deal.
What one of your album tracks do you wish would have been a single?
Oh, that's a good question.
You mean the old album? From the old albums? Yeah. Wow.
Living Alive would have been a nice thing.
Yeah, Living Alive would have been.
Living Alive was on, I want to say, our second album, the Light and the Dark album. Produced by a producer named Cliff Branch, and it was a beautiful song. We got a chance to get released as a single. I think it would have done well in that era, you know, at that time.
Mm-hmm. Breaking My Heart too.
Breaking My Heart was another good single.
That's one we wrote. Yeah. That was a good one.
Where Are the Words would have been a good one.
Oh,
too.
Yeah, that was a good one.
That was a co-write between us and a good friend of ours, and never got released as a single. So there's a few. That we wish would have came out, but you know, I mean, as life goes, you never know what's gonna happen, and so we never really, you know, we look back at our experience and we try to appreciate like all the good that it brought, you know, the term accentuate the positive, not really focus on the negative kind of thing, and I think it's brought us good fortune in our lives because we've, you know. A lot of people don't know where we've been, what we've been doing, but we've had good lives. You know, we've had the work, you know, go out there and make money and take care of our families and all that. But, you know, God has blessed us with good health throughout all these years and you know, loving families, you know, great
friends,
children,
good friends,
you know,
quality of life.
Roberto and I have grandbabies already, you know. Larry's not quite yet.
I'm not there yet.
but you know, we've really been very rich in terms of family, you know, in that family unity. And so I would say that in terms of the fame and the success, although we never reached that level of fame that we wanted to, you know, we could look back now in our 50s and say, you know what, that's not really or would not have been the most important thing anyway. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I think the most important thing, we already had that. And we've been able to see that grow and flourish over the years. It's been beautiful. You know,
we just enjoy the fans. I mean, you know,
yeah,
we had the opportunity to meet a lot of people around the world. And that was great in itself. So.
And those fans will appreciate all the songs, all the tracks on those albums, too, which is really nice when people come up to you probably and tell you which songs mean something to them.
Yeah. You know, it's funny because like songs that we never really paid a whole lot of attention to. We get that a lot. A fan will say, my favorite song is so-and-so. We're like, wow, you know, never heard that one. You know what I mean? That was like the last track on the album. We didn't even, you know, it was like the afterthought, right? We need extra. Let's throw that on there. But you're right about that. Everybody's so unique and individual in terms of their taste and style. It really helps you to understand how diversified we are as people. You know, everybody has different tastes, you know, so... the fact that we had so many different styles of songs was kind of nice because we, you know, we kind of cater to everyone in that sense, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, girl, sometimes it's just so hard to find the words to say. So hard. To tell you just what you mean to me, but nobody told me how hard that it would be. In your eyes I see vivid memories, a passionate reminder of how love's supposed to be. We're all the words,
my baby,
for how
to
I feel.
How can I tell you, darling,
that I'm for
real?
What will I say
to you, baby?
What will
Dope Nostalgia listeners, I love you and I thank you so much for being a part of this show and its success over the last 2 years. We have what's called Patreon for those who want to support the show financially. For as little as $1 a month, you can become a subscriber and get bonus content, early podcast release, all kinds of cool behind the scenes stuff, and more. There's different tiers of membership starting at only $1 a month. And we even have some special merch for you guys who are in it for the long run. So please, join our Patreon. It's at www.patreon.com/dopenostalgia.
Let's Watch Something is a casual movie review podcast starring Anthony.
And Jack!
Everyone loves hearing industry professionals talking about their craft.
That's not us.
We're just a couple of movie lovers. A
couple of nerds.
Talking about movies.
So come join us on Let's Watch Something.
With Anthony and Jack. Anchor.fm/LWS.
Or wherever you get your podcasts.
Let's Watch Something.
Let's Watch Something.
Let's Watch Something.
Let's Watch Something.
She was coming home to the jungle and to their wild, untamed love for butter, cut down by cholesterol, until...
Darling, look what I've brought back.
I can't believe it's not butter.
It's the premier spread flavored with real sweet cream buttermilk for a fresh butter taste, but without the cholesterol.
How civilized.
I can't believe it's not butter, the taste you love without the cholesterol.
And I noticed, like, image-wise, too, you guys always look so slick and so stylish.
Oh,
like,
wow.
Yeah. Really cool.
Thank you. Thank you.
Did you guys always choose your own outfits for shoots and such? Or did the record label have to put in stylists? How did it work for you?
The record company kind of had all control of the looks and all that stuff. Yeah. But overall, we look back and say, wow, did we actually wear that on the album cover? Like, we had on the military style coats with boots and pocket watches. Oh. But I mean,
I thought it was great.
For a lot of people, it did work, you know. But
we didn't pick that though.
We didn't pick it.
They came out, we were like, okay, we're gonna put this on. Okay. And then when we put it on, I said, it looks pretty cool. All right, that's cool.
this time around, we're more in control. Right. But the challenging thing is not to come off as a group of grandpas,
right?
But then not try to come off as a bunch of young teenagers either.
Right.
So there's that fine line of you gotta be, you know, clean cut enough, but then have a little bit of swag as well. So
GQ meets the hood.
Yes. Hey, you know what? I think if you look confident when you wear it, that's what matters. No matter what you wear. Okay.
There you go.
I mean, and it's not just being in a musical group where you don't know what to wear anymore. I, as a 43-year-old woman, am like, where do I shop now? I don't want to wear old lady dresses. Like, I'm not ready.
You're 100% correct.
Absolutely right. No doubt.
That's awesome.
But if you feel youthful and you know you're rocking what you wear, I think that's what matters.
I think the youth, I mean, for me, I'm the oldest of the group. But I've always maintained a young spirit.
Right.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, my body's not agreeing with me, but, you know, but internally, I mean, my heart and soul, you know, I still feel the same way as back when I was, you know, a kid, you know, a young man.
Right.
So I think that attitude has helped me, you know, in my lifetime. One of the things that I wanted to mention was that during the course of our hiatus, we always did stay in contact. Like, of course, you know, we're family. Larry's not, you know, blood related, but he's our adopted brother, basically. Mm-hmm. You know, we still attended, you know, family weddings together, birthdays, bar mitzvahs, unfortunately funerals.
Right.
You know, we've always kept that bond. And in between there, we always managed to, you know, slide in a rehearsal, you know, I'm always writing something, and I'm like, look, I came up with these lyrics, right? What do you think? And he'll come up with a melody, and the next time we got together, we'll put a song together, and those songs just went into an archive.
Right.
You know? And now, I just recently retired from my 9 to 5, the end of June. I'm sorry, the end of July.
And congratulations.
Thank you so much. So as soon as my time freed up, it was like, okay, fellas, let's go in the studio. They both have recording studios at the house. So we went and started cutting demos and say, okay, well, these are the list of songs that we want to do. Let's get another project going. And here we are. You know?
Wow. Isn't it so nice that you can be in complete control and record your own stuff now?
Absolutely.
Yes. You can't really put a price on that sort of creative license, you know, that control. It's really been a whole new experience for us to be able to take some of the songs that we're actually doing on this project were songs that we wrote many years ago. And actually submitted to the labels, and they turned them down, you know.
But when you hear them, you're going to be like,
our very first single, in fact, was written that Roberto and I wrote that back in 96, believe it or not.
Yeah.
And it's gonna be our first single out in December. So, you know, I don't think many people will believe it, but we've always tried to lean towards, you know, lyrics that would be relatable and timeless and melodies that would be timeless. So most people won't even believe that it was written that long ago. But
when they hear the track, they're going to be like, wow, okay.
Yeah. Well, that's the thing about lyric and melody is that I think you can take a lyric and melody from any era, any decade, and make it current. I mean, look what you did with Sukiyaki, right?
Yes,
true. Very true.
So you're it really doesn't matter when you originally wrote the song. If it's a good song, it's going to stand the test of time anyway.
Amen.
That's true.
Amen.
That is true.
Yeah. Right about that.
You're preaching, girl.
Very good.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I don't know what's come over me. I'm just like, oh, I'm so inspired.
Not to turn the tables, but really quick, if you wouldn't mind telling us your experience with music and your love for music of the 90s and how you got to be a podcaster covering 90s artists.
That's nice of you to ask.
No, it's amazing in itself.
Well, I think it's the music that came out, especially in the early 90s. I was 12, 13 years old, so I was very impressionable. I listened religiously to everything that was being played and came out. And during that time, New Jack Swing, I was a big fan of. I was watching, I was loving watching Arsenio Hall all the time.
Great show. I
just kind of embraced it all, and it kind of created me musically as who I wanted to be. Eventually, I ended up making my own music.
Okay.
Had a band for 15 years. And when that wrapped up, I said to myself, I was like, what do I want to do? I would love to start a show like this and talk about some of the songs and the musicians that influenced me back in the day. So that's how this ended up being.
Wow,
that's amazing.
What a great story.
That is amazing.
Thank you. Fantastic.
Good for you.
Yeah.
And now here we are. I was telling the fellas that this time around in this effort, everything is happening just so automatically, and not so much easy, but it's kind of like if we talk about something and say, okay, we need to do this, and we put it out in the universe, next thing you know, that resource shows up, that connection shows up. Somebody says, hey, I know somebody. Right. Let me introduce you. And everything's just been falling into place, like as if the time that we've taken off has finally put us in a place where it's time for us to do this. Because, you know, we've thought about it for years.
Right.
And we've also had, you know, friends and family. When are you guys going to put out some new music? But bills, you got mortgages, you got car payments, you got kids that are always, hey, I need money for my cell phone, I need money for
kids
my
in rent. College.
All of that stuff kind of prevented us from actually, you know, getting in the lab and putting all the time in.
Mm-hmm.
But now, finally, we have the time,
right?
We have the right energy, I believe,
right? Resources,
and we have this archive of a multitude of songs. I think we probably each have you know, between 50 and 100 songs a piece that have just, they could be just verses, titles of songs. We just took everything that was as close to a song as possible and said, okay, this needs new lyric. This melody needs to be changed here. Right. We also have one of the first four songs that we did. It's two songs that I wrote, and we took the verses from one song and we took the hook from another song and made a totally complete new
That's
one.
That's right.
You know what I mean? Yes. So it's kind of like it's just falling into place, and we're so excited and we can't wait for the world to hear it. And we're glad you're actually our first interview under this new project.
Oh, good. I'm so happy to share this with everybody.
Thank you.
Appreciate you doing this for us too.
No problem. Is there any kind of technology, especially back then when the internet was new back in the 90s? And did you guys embrace the internet when it came out, or was it kind of like, I don't know about this?
Yeah, that's
well, when it first came out, you know, I went and paid money for a computer, but I tried to get on the internet, and it was when you hit the start button. I'm
like, AOL.
Yeah, that's how far that's back. Funny. But it was crazy. I think the technology that I latched on to was, like I said, in Japan, we got introduced to the mini disc players and different types of portable DAT recorders. I purchased one of the first digital workstations made by Yamaha.
Right.
You know, cool. Everything on it was in Japanese. So I had to figure out how to, you know, work it, you know, just by pressing the buttons and all that stuff. But yeah, all that, anything that had to
no English instructions.
being able to record the voice and do tracks and pre-demo our songs. Yeah. I got real attached to that kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah. So you did embrace it right off the bat. Yeah. I think all that exposure in Japan really helped you. You probably ahead of the curve from people back here still hadn't seen this stuff.
Especially with the gadgets. I think we surprised some people with some stuff that we came home with.
All right. I want to make sure to, do you have some social media, obviously on your shirt? I can tag you in all of those.
Yeah.
And your Facebook, your Twitter, everything. Good.
They should all be up and running. We're right in at the start of really starting to upload content. So we just negotiated a deal with, like I said, our marketing team and all that. So because we're releasing in December, I'm thinking probably real soon within the
mid-November, we'll start having all the platforms loaded with photos, video clips.
Stuff we have. Good.
Over the years, another technology that I latched on to really quick was video. So I have video of performances that we did in Japan where we were, you know, much thinner and younger, and we actually had hair on our heads.
Don't worry. The Lay's potato chips haven't changed you guys. You look great.
But yeah, so we have all this content. We have flyers from almost all the shows that we ever we're performing at. We have the actual tickets to get into the dinner shows that we did, all that stuff. And I have three trunks that stack, and the top trunk had all cassettes of demos that we recorded.
Right.
The second trunk had a Hi-8 videotape cassette.
Oh, no way.
And the bottom, bottom one was all VHS tapes of stuff that we've done.
Yeah.
And then a slew of photos and magazine clippings, this and that. So all that stuff we had digitally,
right?
I'm sorry, enhanced to as close to 4K as possible.
Right.
And all of that stuff is going to come in as a kind of a history, because the US audience especially never got to see us on stages and in that format.
Yeah.
You know, it was overseas that really got to see us live on stage.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
I'm so glad that you did. Sorry, Larry?
Especially with a band. I mean, we in Japan, we perform with bands all the time.
Yes.
Where here in the US, I mean, we went out on tour with Kim Waters who was our band director at the time. So we did do a little bit of the band stuff, but not as much as we did overseas.
Yeah.
So, so we got some clippings that people will be very interested, like, wow, look at that.
It's always nice to meet a real band.
Always.
Because I know sometimes you have to go on like appearances, these TV appearances and whatnot, and you're singing to a backing track, or some of the shows back in the day made people lip sync, right?
Yes.
We did most of ours a cappella.
Yeah. Our tapes would break in the middle of shows, and we would just have to continue a cappella.
And that's how you know you can do it. Everyone knows they're real.
Exactly.
Are there any collaborations you'd like to make?
Wow, that's a good question.
So many. Like I said, we write our own songs. You know, the first two albums, they just push writers for us ahead. Right. You know, and unfortunately, whatever record sales happened, everybody got paid, and we're kind of like, hey, man, if you would have let us, you know, do our own songs, we could have seen some money too. But I always admired the songwriter, musician, the Babyfaces, the John Legends, you know, people that can actually sit down, play an instrument and sing that that composition. Unfortunately, I never got the instrument down back. But, you know, you give me some music and a pen and a pad of paper and I'll go to town.
Nice. So, I mean, he mentioned, too, I mean, it would be nice to be able to collaborate with a John Legend, with a Babyface, with an Alicia Keys, and Ed Sheeran. There's a number of people that if they would have us, you know what I mean, we definitely would love to do that.
Oh, that'd be gorgeous, just to have the opportunity, or having the opportunity to sing some beautiful a cappella or beautiful harmonies on one of their tracks, you know?
Yeah.
Oh, that'd be awesome. That'd be awesome.
Sure would.
So who can you hook us up with?
I'm far from being the hookup, I tell you, not yet.
I'll tell you an interesting memory that we had. Like Ray mentioned, when we were on tour promoting and doing our shows, we met a lot of celebrities. Mm-hmm. And we shared the stages with a lot of them, but we got to personally interact outside of the, you know, concert venues or radio stations. Yeah. We were what's the name of the amusement park in California?
Six Flags? Oh, Knott's Berry Farm?
It was one of the amusement parks. It was in Los Angeles, in LA.
Yeah.
It wasn't Disney. It was some magic something, whatever.
I'm not sure.
But anyway, we're there. We're on the lines, getting ready to get on a roller coaster. And lo and behold, behind us, it's the four members of All For One.
Nice.
So, you know, we've done performances together. You know, we've performed with them in Seattle and in Portland, Oregon. Here we are in LA, and we're just hanging out on a day off. And what was interesting was that everybody else on the line was, is that All For One? Is that 4 p.m., this and that? And what we did to all those people online is that they sang Sukiyaki, and we sang So In Love. So they're looking at us, but they were confused. They were like, wait a minute.
Right.
That's not your song.
That's supposed to be the other way around.
Yeah.
Oh, that makes it fun for everybody.
We've been friends with them all these years. In fact, Delius is the one that, one of the lead singers for them, is the one that we've sort of kept in contact with more.
Yeah, I stay in touch with him regularly. So.
Yeah.
Oh, legends. You guys are all legends.
Thank you.
Thanks.
I'm grateful for our time today. You've been one of my favorite interviews. You're so lovely. So thank you.
Thanks for having us. Thank you. Really appreciate it. And we hope to do it again, you know, down the road when once we release some music. I'd be happy to have you back. We get the new album a little bit out there and more established. We'd love to definitely talk to you again.
I'd like to see what you think about the songs. We want to hear what your input is on.
Yeah.
Oh, 100%. I'd be down for that. Before we wrap it up, I always like to ask people too about what kind of foods or fashion trends, toys, anything of that line would make you nostalgic for the 90s.
Ooh.
Mm.
Wow.
Food, fashion trends.
Fashion trends.
It's interesting, you know, just recently I went on, just a story that kind of takes us back. I went on a vacation, my wife and I, we just took a weekend away, kind of a retreat to get away from the house and the kids and all that stuff. And the resort had had an arcade, and all the games were set for free. Like you just hit the button and they had Pac-Man and Galaxian and all these games. And I was like, it was like a kid at a candy store.
Nice.
There you go.
Because those are some of my favorite games, Pac-Man, Galaxian and all that. So just the whole Atari phase, the whole, you remember the little football game that used to have the
little line.
Dodge the lines? And you know, I don't know if you remember that. You remember that?
Yeah, I remember those.
But they were like some of the first little digital handheld games that ever came out. I mean,
I remember that. Yeah.
These little digital dots that you just kind of, that was you, and you had to dodge the other ones and get and run a touchdown. You know, I think that those were things that I kind of, I guess, just have a memory of being really a lot, real fun. Mm-hmm. And I wish they would bring them back.
Members only jackets. Remember the members only jackets?
Yes. Ooh, that's a good one.
Yeah. These are the members only jackets. I think I would like some of the old fashioned from back in our, you know, I think my 30s.
Okay.
And that era we lived in New York.
Yeah.
And in New York, there was a time where everybody worked the 9 to 5. On Friday, people would go get a fresh haircut, go to the men's shop, and buy a new outfit from head to toe, shoes, mm-hmm. socks, slacks, belt, even the coat. And they would meet at a local park called Arthur Park Poe Park. I'm sorry. Yeah, Poe Park. And everybody's all dressed up to the nines, hanging out and deciding, okay, there's a party at this club, there's a party over here, this and that, where are we going to go? Okay, we're going to hit this one first, then we'll go to that one. Right. Everybody can get into a cab, shoot downtown, and party till 6 o'clock in the morning. Mm-hmm. But the fact is that everybody was clean and crispy.
Right. Right.
When we went to, Larry and I went to New York to shop for the photo shoot. I went to all my old stomping grounds to where I knew they had the men's stores with the highest fashions. There was not one left.
Not one left.
Yeah.
It was heartbreaking.
It was heartbreaking. You know where you can go get those unique European shoes and slacks and everything was just, it was terrible.
Yeah. We're coming to Canada. We're coming to Canada.
I live in a city that has like one of the biggest malls in the world. So we'll hook you up.
Okay. Hey,
it's got good shopping.
Actually, what part of Canada are you from?
I'm in Western Canada, and I live in a city called Edmonton.
Okay.
Okay. All right. We definitely heard of it.
Yes.
Oh, sweet.
We did Toronto. We did Quebec. We did Montreal, and we did Saskatoon.
Saskatoon.
Yeah, we call it Saskatoon.
Yeah, man.
That was a hilarious experience
It sure was.
Yeah.
I think one of the weirdest experiences I had is we came out of the club. It was a late night show. We came out and it was bright as noonday outside.
Oh, it was like,
and we were all just shocked. Like, what's going on? So we went to the hotel and we couldn't sleep because there was so much sunlight coming in. But they did have curtains to sort of darken the room.
Yeah.
But it was so bright out that we ended up, I think, going out to breakfast at 2 a.m., 3 a.m. We stood out.
Yeah.
Just a very, very, very crazy experience. I don't think we've ever had that happen to us before, you know, so.
Oh, yeah. It's fun in the summer, like obviously at the end of June, the longest day of the year. Yeah. It doesn't get dark till probably 11:30 p.m. And then, where I am in Edmonton. And Edmonton's one of the more northern cities.
Okay.
Yeah.
So 11:30 p.m. And then the sun starts coming up around 3:30, 4 a.m.
That's crazy.
Wow.
That's so wild. So do people actually stay up and are they running at that to 11 p.m.
I'm a night owl, so I do. But most people, they've got the blackout curtains. I'm
sure.
Okay.
Okay. Cool.
Oh, I thank you so much, guys. You were amazing. I appreciate you.
So much fun. Thanks for making this so cool for us and
thank you
and joyous.
I just, Marcel, where are you going with that disc? You are not putting that on again. Marcel, okay, if you press that button, you are in very, very big trouble.
I don't know which way to go.
Never catch me. Unless you follow us on Twitter at NostalgiaDope, Instagram at Dope_Nostalgia. Visit our website at www.DopeNostalgia.com or pick up the phone and call us at 780-851-8785 and cut it out.
This podcast is licensed by SoCan because we believe that artists should be paid for their work.